The next item of business is a debate on motion 13091 in the name of Liam Kerr on supporting Scotland's colleges. I'd be grateful if members who wish to speak in the debate were to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Liam Kerr to speak to and move the motion up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do move the motion because, Presiding Officer, Scotland's colleges are the linchpin around which the future of Scotland depends. A bold statement, perhaps, but backed up by the 2023 Fraser-Vallander report, which states, inter alia, Scotland's colleges will generate additional value worth £20 billion for the Scottish economy. Graduates each deliver an additional £55,000 boost to productivity over their working lives. The total public sector cost of investing in these learners is roughly a third of the cumulative tax revenues generated, and Scotland's colleges employ directly around 11,000 staff, providing local economic boosts. That means colleges add huge value, much more than they cost, to the national and local economy. But evidence shows it also means they deliver faster, sustainable economic growth by, for example, supplying employers with a skilled workforce. They provide better employment prospects, increased earning potential, lower likelihood of unemployment, and a positive effect on health and well-being, leading to better physical health outcomes, longer life expectancy, improved social mobility. So how does the SNP government, to quote a line from its manifesto, recognise the vital role of Scotland's colleges? Well, years of flat cash settlements, a cut to the net college resource budget of almost £59 million, a reported nearly half a billion pound funding gap over 3 years, which, although the Minister disputed it last week and couldn't say what he thinks he is, may well be higher due to capital costs, which leads to Audit Scotland warning that risks to the college sector's financial sustainability have increased, and the SFC identifying three colleges with significant cash flow issues, which the Public Audit Committee heard is actually four, which in turn, according to the SFC, puts 21% of the college workforce at risk by 2026 and directly impacts resource allocation to teaching and learning, thereby impacting learners and their educational experience, according to College Employers Scotland. It's an appalling situation. But what I think the colleges, the students, and indeed the employers fear the most is epitomised by the government's amendment today. Because despite all the reports, all the warm words, all the praise, this government is missing in action. Last week, I asked a topical question about the state of Scotland's colleges under the SNP and asked how the government's priorities might need to change. Richard Leonard asked whether the most marginalised bear the brunt of the situation. Pam Duncan Glancy asked about whether the government would intervene in a dispute. To each, the minister, diligently reading from a pre-prepared script, talked about opposition parties demanding more money in the budget. But we didn't. And during last night's college debate, the minister blamed the opposition, Brexit, Tories, but failed to acknowledge the blame lies entirely with the occupants of the government benches. Presiding Officer, my authority for that statement is in March 2023. The Education Committee reported that it is concerned colleges are currently making decisions to respond to the challenging financial climate without clear, overarching strategic direction from the Scottish Government as to their purpose and what they must prioritise. They're still waiting. In 2020, the Cumberford Little report made a number of recommendations which might begin to address the situation, not based on funding. 4 years on, and there's no substantive implementation or action, except perhaps that instead of expanding the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, they abandoned it. Presiding Officer, the Withers Review reported about a year ago, made 15 recommendations to reform the post-school learning and skills landscape. We still don't know what the government will do or when. The national bargaining system, which is imbued with, quote, a debilitatingly low level of trust, was the subject of the Strathesk Lesson Learned report, commissioned by the Scottish Government. It submitted recommendations to the Scottish Government in March 2022. What's happened at government level since? Absolutely nothing. Presiding Officer, under the current funding model, under which colleges can't borrow to, for example, renew digital infrastructure and estates, or retain end-of-year surpluses to mitigate the next crisis, there exists, according to the Education Committee, a general lack of flexibility to be able to respond to economic and societal needs and priorities. That's why the Education Committee recommended the Scottish Government give colleges as many, quote, financial and operational flexibilities as possible. This could include, but not be limited to, flexibility for year-end, flexibility on SFC outcomes, flexibility in terms of access to additional funds. That was last year. Has it happened? No. 4 years ago, the SFC said that... if I have time, I will. Presiding Officer...
We have no extra time.
We have no extra time. Regrettably, Michelle Thompson, I shall not take intervention then. 4 years ago, the SFC said that because of tensions in governance and accountability structures, contested costs and funding authority, and unclear outcome gains for students and taxpayers, the current structure of the governance in multi-college regions was not tenable. Has the not tenable structure been dealt with 4 years on? No, Presiding Officer. It has not. I'll take a very quick intervention, Michelle Thompson, if you're... Are you ready?
Michelle Thompson.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you allow me to intervene. I greatly appreciate it. I was merely going to make the point that I, too, am in great favour of fiscal flexibility, particularly around capital expenditure and flexibility year-end, consulting heavily with the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Why does he want that for colleges and not for his own government?
Liam Kerr.
I think we'd need to stay on point, particularly where the time's constrained, Michelle Thompson, because the fact is that colleges, talented students, their staff are crucial to the future of Scotland and all of its people. Yet this government surveys the damage its failure to lead from the future has led to. It fails to come up with any vision, any strategy, any meaningful action, and instead lodges amendments which represent an utter abdication of ministerial responsibilities. The government must act to address the present and future of our colleges now, or in a hollowed out sector, who does the minister think will step up to tackle economic downturns, to upskill and reskill, to mitigate skills gap, to support lifetime learning? Presiding Officer, if this minister and this government will not go beyond warm words on colleges to saving them, then stand aside and let someone in who will before it's too late.
Thank you. I now call on Graham Day to speak to and move Amendment 13091.3 up to 5 minutes, Minister.
General Officer, thank you. The First Minister has been clear that the government he leads will be committed to attempting to engage constructively with other parties in this chamber and defining areas of agreement where that's possible. And that, of course, sets a clear expectation on the approach to be adopted by ministers, but also in opposition parties. In what is a parliament where no party has a majority, it's a duty of all of us to work, if not together, then in a considered and reasonable way, treating issues on merit. In this new environment, government cannot impose its will in parliament. Equally, the other parties need to decide whether they will oppose simply for the sake of it, set out wish lists with no identified path to deliver them, or look to engage constructively. In responding to today's Conservative motion, I will seek to rise to the challenge the First Minister set those of us on these benches. The motion before us talks about inadequate funding of colleges and calls for us to at least look at how we look at improving matters. And let me acknowledge that the budgetary settlement for colleges isn't what I would want it to be. Although, Presiding Officer, in the interest of balance, it is worth noting that over the last 10 years, we have increased the college resource budget by over £121 million in cash terms. But I don't want to get into a to-ing and fro-ing here. There's lots of things that I could throw back at Liam Kerr, but, Presiding Officer, we've rehearsed those arguments before, and I want to focus on the substance. I'm not going to because I've got 5 minutes. So I want to focus on the substance of the issue of colleges. That's the challenges and the opportunities for them. Now, last week I acknowledged that there are challenges facing colleges. Of course there are. I also accept that there's a gap between what the colleges would have had at their disposal now if funding had risen in line with inflation over the past few years. Now, of course, if the Conservatives believe that we ought to have been raising the funding in line with inflation, and presumably they must take serious issue with the fact that despite the Chancellor pointing to real terms growth in public spending, the core block grant is still less in real terms in 24-25 compared to 22-23 by around £500 million. And that's the gap that's arisen in just 1 year, and that exceeds the alleged shortfall in college funding that's been claimed. And they must, of course, be even more troubled by forecasts which suggest our block grant for capital is expected to reduce in real terms by almost 9% by 2027-28. Because you cannot, on the one hand, insist that funding by the Scottish Government must rise by inflation, then accept that the funding of it should fall. Briefly.
Liam Kerr.
I'm missing the point. I specifically didn't talk about funding and talked about all the reports giving alternative solutions. If the ONS classification were reviewed, colleges might build reserves. What's the Minister's view of that?
Minister.
And the point, as he well knows, is that we are bringing to a head a lot of the outcomes and suggestions from those reports. I'm going to try and cover that in opening, but also in closing as well, because I think he knows that is the case. We've got to find a way forward, taking account of some of these reports, which ensures that colleges are on a sustainable long-term footing. And that's simply not going to be available from an injection of public cash, which isn't available to us. And the reform programme, which is driven by these reports that we're embarking upon, will place colleges at the heart of the post-16 skills delivery. We're acting on what the reviews have told us about the need for change to ensure our learning and our education system is fit for the future. For example, the government will take a central role in the delivery of skills planning at a national level, recognising the central role for government in shaping the skills need. But in so doing, we'll work with the public, private and third sector to ensure that the offer is fit for purpose. And colleges are going to be central to this. We're working directly with them on that already. For example, the development of a college's first principle for certain apprenticeship areas, which Glasgow Clyde College Principal John Vincent is leading on. That's a good example of what I'm talking about. We've also got them in the room as we work with employers on identifying skill shortages and how the offering of colleges can be better aligned to the needs of employers and the economy. It's important that decisions to fund Scotland's college sector are made facing forwards, looking towards what we need both now and in the future, so that decisions are not reactive, and that takes account of these reviews. That's going to require thoughtful leadership from across the sector and beyond, and it's important that we are upfront about that. And I can assure the Parliament that the Scottish Government is working extremely hard with stakeholders, such as the Funding Council and Colleges of Scotland, to work through this period together. I was due to sit down with Colleges of Scotland and the Colleges Chairs in Stirling this afternoon as part of the ongoing engagement. The scheduling of this debate forced the cancellation of those sessions, but they will be rearranged. And, Presiding Officer, regardless of who holds this post following the ministerial reshuffle which is underway, I know the Scottish Government will remain committed to that close working, which I believe will lead to the shaping of a college sector which can deliver local and national priorities, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. And I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to and move Amendment 13091.1. Up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. Just yesterday we had the opportunity to debate colleges in Scotland, and I'm pleased that we have had the same chance to do so again today. In my role, I've had the privilege of meeting college staff and principals that are going above and beyond for their college. I've heard lecturers and support staff up and down the country share, with passion, stories about the subjects they teach and the students they empower. And I've heard about the ways in which colleges serve their communities and build our workforce of the future. Incredible college staff and talented students work day in, day out to do all of this, but they are doing so in the face of a government who have, for 17 years, and several education secretaries later, including John Swinney, let them down. Members will have read the articles in the Herald recently that show just how bad it is, and I'd like to take a moment to put on the record my thanks to the Herald and James McKinney and his team for shining a light on it. The reports highlight what trade unions, staff, colleges and students have been warning for years, that Scotland's colleges face an eye-watering funding shortfall and that this funding gap has real-life consequences, not least the drop of over 125,000 students attending college since 2008-2009. And, Presiding Officer, let's remind ourselves who those students are. More than 40% are over 25. A third come from the most deprived areas. 15% are disabled, 17,000 are black and minority ethnic, 3,000 are care experienced. Colleges lift glass, class and step ceilings in the way of opportunity, and we should support them. But they can only do this with the support of their government. Presiding Officer, colleges can't afford another day of inaction from this government or a lack of leadership from this minister. The situation has been called a burning platform. Audit Scotland have warned that colleges can't deliver the same for less. And Colleges Scotland have said that colleges have impossible choices ahead. And here's what some of those impossible choices look like in reality. Staff in one college are saying books are being taken out of the library. Student support, careers advisors and personal academics tutors are being cut. In another, the college is cutting courses where senior phase pupils go to study advanced hires in areas we know we need people to be skilled in. There are campuses facing closure and students with fewer options. Across Scotland, jobs are at threat. College Employers Scotland are saying their members simply don't have the resource to negotiate the existing pay offer, and industrial relations hang by a thread. And most worrying of all, the Public Audit Committee was told that four Scottish colleges may not survive the year. I will take the intervention.
Prosecutor.
I'm grateful to Ms Duncan Glancy for taking that intervention. Her colleague Richard Leonard made an interesting suggestion last night that the money currently being allocated by enterprise agencies in Scotland to arms dealers like BAE could in fact be reallocated to Scotland's colleges. This would maybe generate a couple of million pounds a year. I'm wondering if that is the official position of the Labour Party, because if so, it would certainly have the support of the Greens.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I note that he voted for the budget that has delivered savage cuts to colleges across Scotland, and so I'll take no lessons or suggestions for him on this. I ask the minister today, is he prepared for this to happen on his watch, or is he willing to step up? On funding, can he set out a timeline on development and delivery of a new funding model for college, and will he deliver an emergency funding package to help voluntary redundancy schemes in the meantime? On buildings, will he reintroduce a buildings condition survey to inform investment plans and to help colleges deal with RAC? On delivery, will he support colleges and principals to test ways of meeting the needs that they have for the future? On pay, will he provide direction and say whether he accepts calls for pay in line with public sector pay and that colleges need help to deliver that? And finally, on industrial relations, will he fix the flawed national machinery that's meant to govern it? Will he ensure that everyone involved gets facility and support time to engage properly? And will he get round the table with colleges and trade unions before the summer recess to facilitate a solution that will end the industrial dispute? Presiding Officer, in closing, these are questions that people in the sector need answers to. Yesterday, someone in this chamber said they wouldn't envy the position of the minister.
Ms Duncan Glancy.
Presiding Officer, I would envy the position of the minister, because I would relish the opportunity to serve in government and make the changes that need to happen. And Scottish Labour are ready to do that, even where they are not. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Ross Grier.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll start off with an admission that much of what I'm about to say is exactly the same as I said last night when we covered similar issues. I absolutely believe the Scottish Greens believe that colleges have a critical role to play in building a fairer, greener Scotland and in delivering on key missions that we all agree on, whether it's the climate action required to hit net zero or tackling child poverty. Education is a social good and an individual good. It can be genuinely transformational. But we shouldn't pretend that a good education will remove all the structural inequalities that people face in society. It is, though, a key ingredient to a successful society. And by success, I'm not just talking about GDP wealth or even average incomes, though the latter is clearly important. But a successful society is one where we're collectively able to meet everybody's needs and to give every individual an opportunity of a happy, healthy life. The ability of our colleges to play their role in that, though, has been hugely held back by a decade of chronic problems in industrial relations in particular. And I think it is an example of class inequality in this country that that has gone on for so long with so little attention, whether it be from political figures or from the media, compared to far less frequent industrial action, either in schools or in the university sector. Well, what would the Scottish Greens do differently? For a start, I won't join in the hypocrisy of others who voted against raising more money for public services via progressive taxation or proposed any other alternative savings options but are somehow demanding more money. And we've just seen where one Labour member makes a proposal to reallocate money and the Labour front bench effectively slapped that down. But there are other options that we can take. For a start, on fair work conditionality. The Scottish Funding Council should absolutely make it conditional on the funding of colleges that they eliminate zero-hours contracts, implement pay ratios and other fair work conditions. This would demonstrate to the lowest paid staff in particular that they are valued. I'm afraid I've only got 4 minutes, so I won't be able to. What I want to see from the Funding Council as well, I will take an intervention from Ms Duncan Glancy, given my intervention.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I thank the member for taking that intervention, and he mentions fair work and an ending to zero-hour contracts. So can I ask the member, does he support Labour's New Deal for working people then?
Ross Grier.
I don't know if the Labour member has seen the news today, but her party's just watered down its own working new deal for working people to the point that Unite the Union have just described it, I believe, as a grotesque betrayal. So she should maybe take that up with her party leader this afternoon. Presiding officer, what we need to see is far more enforcement by the Scottish Funding Council of fair work conditions, both national fair work conditionality, but also locally agreed fair work conditions between individual colleges and unions. As far as I can tell, the outcome agreements that are supposed to include this are barely scrutinised by the Funding Council. We need to see far, far more robust scrutiny. I'm proud of the fact that college boards must now include at least two trade union representatives, a policy that was delivered by the Scottish Greens in our time in government. But I think college governance overall needs to be strengthened to a far greater degree. And I would urge the Minister to take into consideration proposals to include local elected representative councillors on college boards to ensure that colleges are rooted in their local community and that there's a connection between colleges and councils as two key drivers of local economies. I think we really need to consider the issues that we've seen in specific colleges like City of Glasgow, where the board are unable or unwilling to provide the kind of effective scrutiny of senior management that is required. It was only when the local industrial dispute was taken out of that local setting and addressed at a regional level that progress was made. And I think that the proximity of board members to senior management was a key contributing factor in how protracted and distasteful, I would say, that dispute became. Presiding officer, there are far more proposals that we could go through. We should be moving college principals into the chief executive pay framework element of the public sector pay policy. It is not right that a number of college principals in this country are paid more than the First Minister. We do need to address the recommendations made in the Strathesk report. That will require both sides moving out of their comfort zones. There's so much more we can do. As a parliament of minorities, we do now have the opportunity to come together on points of agreement and do that. I hope that we will seize that opportunity.
Thank you, and I now call on Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If only Ross Grier and his party had been in government for the last 2.5 years, we might have seen a bit of a difference. The government's policy on colleges has lacked coherence for some time. Let me provide a few examples. Creating national pay bargaining, raising expectations of pay rises, but failing to provide the funds for colleges to deliver that. Adopting a policy of no compulsory redundancies, hinting that it applies to colleges before excluding colleges from that policy. Proclaiming colleges as a characteristically Scottish route to a degree, but cutting their funds over the last 17 years. Talking of skilling and reskilling, but cutting student places. When government funds are short, merging colleges and bringing them closer to government, but limiting their freedom to raise funds themselves. Now, the Minister is trying his best to change that with his work on skills and apprenticeships, but he must recognise the weaknesses of the legacy that he has been handed. Colleges can be responsible for greater social mobility, improving life chances, economic growth, for meeting the skills needs of our transformed economy. But for that to be a success, there needs to be a change of government priorities. And for the record, my party has repeatedly included colleges in our costed budget proposals, but these were rejected by successive finance secretaries. In that context, it would have been helpful if Ross Grier had used his previous influence in government to halt the £26 million cut to colleges instead of pretending today that the college cut had nothing to do with him and the Greens. Although technically ministers have no direct role in pay negotiations, the intervention of the Education Secretary in the teachers' pay dispute and made the cut to college budgets as a result of the teachers' pay rise rubbed salt into the wound for college staff. The minister, therefore, has a duty to seek a resolution to the industrial disputes that have bedevilled the sector for a decade. But it isn't all about money and industrial relations. I want to see college-school partnerships grow to spread the use of qualifications like the foundation apprenticeships and others. Greater skills and education intelligence so we can meet the needs of employers today and future skill needs. Flexibility to meet the intelligence with support from qualification bodies, with coordination between colleges to ensure specialist provision is maintained. But finally, in my last minute, can I raise concerns about changes at SRUC Elmwood Campus in Cooper in my constituency? Although most animal care courses have been saved from closure, and the SRUC leadership tell me that they are committed to a future at Elmwood, I'm concerned about the slow progress towards the new facilities planned to accommodate the provision. I have relayed my concerns to the principal, but it would be helpful if the minister could intervene too. I hope he'd be willing to do that and perhaps comment on that in his summing up. I want a thriving Elmwood campus, as do staff, students and the wider community. But we've got a lot of work to make sure that that happens. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to open debate speeches, and I call Sue Webber to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've always been very impressed by the work that's been done in our colleges, and these institutions are critical to the economic and social well-being of our country. For the development of a skilled workforce able to respond to new requirements and the new opportunities in industries, for opportunities for people of all abilities to develop skills for life, and for successfully widening access to opportunities, including higher education. And as James Withers said, Scotland has all the ingredients of a world-class education and skills system, and no ingredient is more important than our colleges. It has never been more important to unlock the full potential of all our people. One third of our college students come from Scotland's most deprived communities, which put simply means that colleges deliver education and skills development to parts of Scotland other institutions just don't reach. Sounds like an advert. Their role as a catalyst for economic development is also underplayed. The SNP's chronic underfunding of Scotland's colleges has forced them into a precarious financial position, impacting their ability to support learners and grow the economy. Earlier this year, colleges, businesses and trade unions joined together to call on the Scottish Government to reinstate a vital training fund before it was deleted from the 2024-25 budget. The Flexible Workforce Development Fund has previously provided businesses with access to training and upskilling for staff, delivered through colleges and other partners. And we heard in February that this meant that potentially over 2,000 employers and 45,450 learners will miss out on training opportunities. What a tragedy. They will miss out on that opportunity if the £10 million fund is not reinstated. And I also want to raise an issue about modern apprenticeships as a whole. Based on the SSVQ calculations, those studying for a modern apprenticeship qualification in Scotland receive considerably less funding per head than those in England. A barbering apprentice receives only £2,700 compared to £9,000 south of the border, and a hospitality apprentice receiving only half of what their counterparts in England receive. So I'm hoping that the Minister, when he closes in his remarks later on, can give his reiterations as to, and I understand that budgets are tight, but why is there such a disparity in funding here? And where exactly is the apprenticeship levy money in Scotland that you receive? Where on earth is it going? The Education, Children and Young People Committee report on college regionalisation noted concern over a lack of overarching strategic direction from the Scottish Government. And the report stated the committee is concerned that colleges are currently making decisions to respond to the challenging financial climate without clear overarching strategic direction from the Scottish Government as to their purpose and what they must prioritise. And as such, colleges are being asked to take decisions for the future, uncertain as to where those decisions will be compatible with the Scottish Government's vision. There were many other recommendations in that report, and I am very aware that the Minister is aware of those recommendations, given he was a member of the committee and helped draft those, given it was a unanimous report that we agreed on. And whilst I recognise the financial constraints the Scottish Government is working within, both the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council must acknowledge the significant needs of the college sector and urgently take action to ensure that more capital investment can be levered into the sector. I will, if I'm permitted.
Minister.
Well, I can contradict what I said at the start of the contribution, but if she wants more money for the Flexible Workforce Development Fund and more money for colleges and more money for apprenticeships, from where does she suggest we find it?
In conclusion, Ms Webber.
I have a list of £55.5 million of opportunities if you wish. Mobile phones for prisoners, nothing we would do. £46 million on the next year alone in the botched National Care Service, we would not be doing that. £9 million on foreign embassies, we wouldn't do that. And the Air Miles Angus trips of £14,000, we wouldn't be doing those. I gather from my sources, Minister, that the previous First Minister instructed his Cabinet to get out and visit the colleges in their regions and constituencies, to meet the students and staff and see firsthand the impact that colleges have on communities across the country. I would go further and ask every member of this Parliament to do so and to get behind and support the work done by our colleges, the unsung heroes of our education sector.
Thank you, and I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I start with a declaration of interest. A few years ago, I was part of a research study that contributed towards the eventual creation of UHI Shetland. From the outset of becoming an MSP, I have forged a close relationship with Forth Valley College. I've also spoken at events in City of Glasgow College, and I can see the huge investment in both colleges in recent years, enabling them to create world-standard learning environments. And they're not alone in Scotland. And like many in this chamber, I wish the financial situation was different and that we could simply turn on a tap to invest more in Scotland's colleges. But thanks to the Tories, our capital budget has been cut, and we have to acknowledge that Brexit, amongst other Tory insanities, has created real problems for the education sector. Let me consider Forth Valley College. It's Scotland's first regional college with state-of-the-art campuses across the Central Belt in Alloa, Falkirk and Stirling. It wouldn't have had these state-of-the-art facilities without the support of the SNP government. And it welcomes 13,500 students per academic session, with 94% of its learners progressing to further studies or employment. Critically, college funding nowadays is based on establishing outcome agreements with the Scottish Funding Council. This, again, was thanks to SNP government reforms. And it supports identification of the real economic and skills needs of the region it serves and contributes to the college's strategic education, training and lifelong work.
Liam Kerr.
Very grateful. Does the member think then that moving to a single funding pot rather than having different funding pots with different reporting, different rules, different bureaucracies would be the way to go?
Michelle Thompson.
I'm not against always looking at means of funding. I always personally will look at efficiencies in funding, how we can do things better. But I suspect the answer is more complex than a simple political line. I'm going back to what I was talking about. The latest version of the strategic direction for Forth Valley College was published in February this year. And reiterating my point about outcomes, I always welcome that approach. And throughout Scotland, our colleges do a remarkable job in addressing our economic needs and providing opportunities for all, and particularly our young people. There's safe and welcoming learning environment for those with disabilities and for older students continuing their lifelong learning journey. They do have areas of expertise that attract students from beyond the region, including some from overseas, and they have strong articulation links with universities. Our college teaching staff are the best paid in the UK, and that reflects the priority we give to investing in colleges. They'll be a key player as we transition to a net zero economy. And for me, as the constituency MSP for Falkirk East, Forth Valley will have a particularly important role in supporting Grangemouth to meet the challenges of the future. Of course, there are challenges to be faced, not least in funding, but in other areas too. The world is changing so fast, the most successful economies are fleet of foot and able to keep pace with technology and innovation. Furthermore, individuals are best equipped to cope with change where they've been able to maximise their development opportunities. And in a matter of agreement, I have spoken in the past, for example, of the Cumberford Little report myself, and that advocated a move from a focus on competence to one of excellence to meet modern economies. And that is something that I continue to agree strongly with and see as an area where further progress can be made. Presiding Officer, I welcome the debate today in colleges, but this is a somewhat lazy motion presented by the Tories, who seem blind to all the problems Tory policies in the UK have created over recent years.
You must
Let's
include
support
Ms. Thompson.
Apologies and ditch the Tories.
Thank you. And I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer. Yesterday afternoon, the Minister for Veterans and Further and Higher Education came along to Parliament to try to tell us that government intervention in the long-running pay dispute in our colleges, which is about to escalate, would fundamentally alter the nature of the voluntary national bargaining process. So I say to him gently this afternoon, did government intervention in the junior doctors dispute fundamentally alter the nature of the bargaining process? Did government intervention in the Agenda for Change NHS workers dispute fundamentally alter the nature of the bargaining process? Or what about our teachers, our local government workers? Did government intervention there fundamentally alter the nature of the voluntary national bargaining process? In the same speech yesterday, the minister accused opposition politicians of sitting on their hands. You couldn't make it up. He was speaking on a motion which I, an opposition politician, had put down. Today we are debating a motion tabled by the Conservatives, an opposition party. The only person sitting on their hands in this Parliament is this minister and this government. So I say to him again, there is nothing more corrupting in politics than remaining inactive and feigning impotence. What the government is doing to resolve the EIS dispute is not even second rate, it is non-existent. And I have to put on the record as well that the very first speech by an SNP minister in the Swinney era was the most anti-trade union government speech I have heard in Parliament in a long time. The Minister for Further Education said that colleges, let me quote him, were within their rights to cut the pay of lecturers who are simply working to contract. That it was perfectly legal. What about the government's commitment to fair work? What about the promotion of good industrial relations? What about the morality of it? This debate today is about what kind of society and what kind of economy we need. So if there is to be a just transition as we decarbonise the economy, it will require the reskilling of many workers, and most of them will not get that from a university degree, but from active vocational training. And there will be a continuous need for reskilling over and over again, for lifelong learning, which our further education colleges will be pivotal to. Presiding Officer, let me finish with the words of the great American socialist Eugene Debs, who said, "When I rise, it will be with the ranks, not from the ranks. Full opportunity for full development is the unalienable right of all." And that's what this debate on further education is about. It's about whether people get opportunity or not, whether our colleges expand or contract, whether working class communities have opportunities which expand or contract. And it is about whether we value the people who make those opportunities possible. Colleges are crucial to our economic well-being, but they are critical to our social progress too. So it is the minister who needs to be realistic. He needs to end his obstinacy and complacency, find from somewhere some vigour and ingenuity, and above all, if values drive budget choices, this government should re-evaluate our further education colleges, starting by properly investing in the people who work in them. If where the money goes is a reflection of your values, start valuing further education.
Thank you. I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Well, it's always a pleasure, Presiding Officer, to follow Richard Leonard. And in fact, I have worn my only red tie as tribute to that privilege that I have. And I don't like to disagree with Pam Duncan-Glancy, but I don't envy the minister who frankly, I do have a personal regard for. He's come to this chamber today to defend the SNP government's stewardship of Scotland's colleges, and that's pretty much mission impossible, because he knows the impact of his government's 17-year programme of cuts, some really brutal cuts in the college sector, and he knows that that pattern of the last 17 years is continuing in the current financial year to the tune of £26 million. And these cuts have had a significant impact on the sector's capability to upskill Scotland's workforce at the very moment in our economic journey when we need those skills. And the description that has been given of the college sector by various speakers in this debate, both on this side of the chamber and on the other side of the chamber, paints a dismal picture of what the SNP has done to Scotland's colleges. Because make no mistake about it, and here I find common cause with Richard Leonard, the college sector is a key driver of equality of opportunity and an engine for economic growth. These cuts of the last 17 years, the cuts of the current financial year, must be reversed. And I know that the Minister is going to stand up any moment and he's going to recite his famous lines and favourite lines about where are you going to find the money from, what are you going to cut in order to reverse the cuts. Well, it's the job of a Scottish Minister to set policy priorities. And if the government have lost the will to set political priorities, have lost the ambition to put Scotland's economy and its people first, then they should move aside and let someone else be the government of Scotland, someone who does have the ambition for our country and its people. And if he uses those well-worn lines, which are so carefully crafted and repeated by the Scottish ministers consistently about spending, then I think it's almost a tacit admission that the SNP has failed to properly prioritise education and skills. And as he said himself, the minister said himself, it's not where he wants the college sector to be. And I say amen to that. So let's change it. If you want to tackle intergenerational poverty and worklessness, if you want to improve national productivity, if you want to create greater equality of opportunity, you don't cut education and skills, you invest in them. And so I have four things that I'm going to ask the Minister if he would be so kind to respond to. And I think all of them are positive. First, will he commit to driving momentum on the delivery of the recommendations of the Withers Review? Because I hear voices in the college sector and elsewhere in the skills sector saying that there has been a loss of momentum around the reforms that Withers recommended. And as has already been said, it is coming up to the first anniversary of the Withers Review. Reform is needed more today than ever before. Second, will he recognise that we need to have an open and honest conversation about what's being delivered for £3.2 billion in the education and skills budget? There's no point us talking about the size of budgets without talking about what is being delivered. Now, Withers makes a good start in this dialogue, this open, transparent and accountable discussion about what it is that's being delivered. It's not enough just to talk about sums of money, it's what is actually coming out at the other end. Third, can I ask the Minister if in his heart of hearts he knows that the current system of funding colleges is overly complicated, bureaucratic and wasteful, because it is. Too many pots, too much needless reporting, too much micromanagement. By all means, agree deliverable outcomes with the colleges.
You must conclude,
but
Mr.
then
Kirk.
Let's leave it to the colleges to deliver them. And last of all, my last point, my fourth point, is about the state of the college's estate. Yeah. The fact is that this has gone on for years. This is not about 1 year's capital budget. This is about several accumulated years of underfunding. I will conclude by saying this. How is the minister going to deal with the seven colleges that have rack on their campuses? What's he going to do about the state of those college estates?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Ruth McGuire, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Colleges are institutions delivering on multiple critical fronts, providing opportunities that allow our people to develop skills, to live more independently and to allow others to take their first steps back into formal education, helping some of those furthest away from the job market. Places of lifelong learning and development, providing a platform where people can improve their skills or develop new interests at any point in their life. And delivering high-quality, highly respected advanced vocational qualifications and professional training, colleges, with their strong links to industry, play a pivotal role in upskilling the workforce in new technologies for new industries, making them absolutely critical to the growth of our economy. Even with all the challenges faced in the education sector, we have to be proud that our colleges and universities are amongst the best in the world, and also acknowledge the achievement of their learners. I recognise, as does the Scottish Government, the range of financial challenges which colleges and universities are managing at the moment. And while the 2024-25 budget has tried to minimise the impact on allocations, teaching, student support, fiscal constraints felt by the UK Government's real terms cuts has left Scotland facing catastrophic underinvestment for our own public sector. Barnett consequentials have fallen in real terms. Presiding Officer, these cuts are not insignificant. Taking into account the GDP inflator, that equates to an 8.4% reduction over a two-year period. Therefore, I do welcome the £2 billion investment by the Scottish Government to Scotland's colleges and universities. I also welcome the commitment to protect the right to free tuition and the continuation of widening access for all in a challenging financial climate. The reckless Tory Brexit has also taken a toll on our education sector. I know they're groaning. We're groaning about Brexit most of the time. Yeah. With the UK no longer able to take part in the Erasmus exchange programme, Scottish colleges have held long-established relationships across the European Union. Many colleges like City of Glasgow College and West College Scotland taking part in Erasmus-funded projects or being awarded the Erasmus Charter for Higher Education. Professor Sarah Prescott from the Royal Society of Edinburgh concluded the impact of Brexit on the student experience was multifaceted, and I quote, from the withdrawal of Erasmus funding to the concurrent decline in student mobility, equal opportunity and recruitment of students from the European Union. I'll take an intervention here.
Liam Kerr.
I wonder if the member can help us understand what a £24 million cut to lifelong learning will have on the student experience.
Ruth McGuire.
I think we're operating in really difficult times. By contrast, college and universities secured 56% less funding from the Turing Scheme than through Erasmus, equivalent to a cut of over £7 million. I think that it's clear to see which government is creating the challenges for colleges and universities. The Scottish Funding Council reported that during the academic year 21-22, while negotiating the cost of living crisis and the public health measures during the pandemic, 86% of college leavers found positive destinations within 6 months of graduating. Presiding Officer, colleges are vital to Scotland's economic success. We have to prioritise opportunities to develop knowledge, skills, values and attributes that enable Scotland's students to fulfil their potential. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call Ross Greer up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should start off with an apology to the convener of the Education Committee, Sue Webber, for not taking her intervention, because, believe it or not, I was actually enjoying Sue Webber's contribution to the debate, because what Ms Webber included were specific proposals for areas that the Conservatives would cut from the budget and reallocate to colleges. And I don't think I agreed with any of them, but I really like the fact that this Parliament is, I hope, moving towards a place where we're actually putting forward these kind of substantial and credible ideas. I did find it surprising, though, that the mention of cutting the £9 million budget for Scotland's overseas embassy network, given that that was actually not a creation of the Scottish Government or the Scottish Executive, but of the previous UK Conservative Government. That was a creation of John Major. It's odd that John Major's position on Scotland's role in the world is now apparently closer to mine than the Scottish Conservative group here in Parliament. But I actually also agreed with the contribution that Liam Kerr made on the fragmentation of funding for colleges. It's a point that many many of us have made over many years. Many independent reviews and reports have also made that point. There is sometimes a need for discrete funding pots to fill specific purposes, but we've reached the point where clearly the college funding landscape, the skills funding landscape, is so fragmented as to create huge inefficiencies and actually waste substantial amounts of money simply on administration. And I also agree that there was a profound lack of strategic direction for further education in Scotland. I do think that is beginning to be addressed, though. We saw that in the publication last year of the Purpose and Principles document, which didn't go into quite as much detail as I would have wanted, particularly in terms of how it related to other strategies, like the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. But it was a start, and it was welcomed by colleges, and I think we do need to acknowledge that that direction is now forthcoming. I mentioned earlier on a long-time Green proposal to move the pay and conditions of college principals into the chief executive pay framework element of public sector pay strategy. I want to build on that a little bit, because it wasn't mentioned today, but it was mentioned in the equivalent debate last night, the comparison between the pay offer being made to college lecturers this year and the public sector pay strategy. And I would caution those who support college lecturers with making that comparison, because the fact that their negotiating structure has been independent for so many years has allowed them to secure far better paying conditions year on year than that of what was in the public sector pay strategy. So as much as chief executives, I think, should be bound by it, because they're not part of any collective bargaining arrangements, I do think we should respect the independence of the collective bargaining arrangements secured by college staff. On the point of the Strathesque report that I mentioned in my opening speech, one area that I think both sides would need to come out of their comfort zone on, but which I do think, even as a temporary measure, would allow us to make some progress, would be the appointment either of, preferably, I think, an independent chair for the NGNC, or at least an independent observer, because many of the issues that we've seen there over years have been occurrences where everybody, both sides, thought they had reached agreement in the room, but when they left the room, it turns out they had very different interpretations of what had actually been agreed. On Willie Rennie's point about the £26 million, if he'd been here in the debate last night, he would have seen that I'm not distancing either myself or my party from that. We were proud to have secured that money for colleges in the budget, but we were then involved in the decision to reallocate it to fulfilling the teacher pay deal. I was in those negotiations with the teachers' unions. It was made very clear to them that as much as they had every right to demand what they were demanding, the money would need to come from somewhere within the education budget. That was the decision that was made. I do want to see that £26 million go back in. But I am proud of the fact that we reached a transformative pay agreement with Scotland's teachers and ended the strike action in that sector. I think I've only got 10 seconds left, unless there's time in hand, Presiding Officer.
You have 10 seconds, Mr Greer.
In that case, with apologies to Mr Lumsden. Presiding Officer, the solution here is, I think, far more funding for our colleges, particularly directly from the private sector, but more democratic governance, more respect for workers, stricter conditions, better accountability. I think that collectively will deliver the better future for Scotland's colleges, and critically for college students, that I do think we can all reach a point of consensus on.
Thank you. And I call on Martin Whitfield, up to 4 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. And it has been a fascinating discussion this afternoon. And I have to, on behalf, unusually perhaps, of the Conservative opposition, apologise to Mr Day that he was having to cancel his meeting today. But I think a certain experience here would teach that actually it's been the opposition who have brought the question of colleges. It's been the opposition who have brought the question of education into this chamber. And to be fair, we have known about the data of the Conservative Opposition Day for some while now. So I think it could have been a good guess that it was going to be on education. It was going to be today. And it's right, because when we listen to the... And it is right today that when you listen to the contributions, there has been an agreement as to the importance, the very fundamental importance, of colleges to our society as a whole, particularly those that are older and outside of formal schooling, those who are challenged by schooling and are trying to find a way back into education, a way to help us in the skills gap that we've had. And this seems to have agreement across this chamber, both today and indeed last night in the very interesting members' debate. And so it comes to what is the challenge. And this is where we have to face a reality that over 17 years, there has been a lack of priority with regard to colleges. They have suffered year after year after year in the face of others. And I think, as Ross Greer rightly pointed out, it was simply taking money out of the colleges that solved the teacher salary challenge. And that was a choice the Scottish Government and the Greens have made. And those choices are important because that is the responsibility of government. That is the responsibility that you take. But with that comes the ability for people to rightly say, what are your priorities? And you can see that by where you spend the money. Because the cuts that have come to education in relation to the colleges is about something as simplistic but as devastating as removing books from a library. It cuts the student learning support. Those individuals who work with our young people, our older people, people who are challenged to stay in college, to say, you can do this. This is how we can help you. The careers advisors that help plot out why the choices that are made by people who choose to go to college can have. And the personal academic tutors that sit down with individuals to help them over the smaller and more difficult problem. The student support teams. Those individuals who've supported people who are now threatened by redundancy. And I have to say, I welcomed so many of the speeches, and in particular Michelle Thompson, who talked about Forth Valley College and rightly pointed out all of the good things. But I would remind her, it was literally a year ago when they went into a 30-day consultation process with the aim of cutting courses, the aim of 13 members of staff losing their job, quote, to ensure the college remains financially sustainable. And I think it is unfair to try and say that there is any college that's in a positive and strong economic position. They are all challenged. Summed up by College Scotland's very own quote, the college sector finds itself on a burning platform. With a combination of real-term cuts over several years, with increased costs related to workforce, inflation and energy, this has left a sector which has the potential to provide so much to learners, communities and the economy in a situation where colleges are cutting staff, reducing courses and having to remove much needed support services from the students who need them most. What is this government's priority? I'm grateful.
Thank you, and I call on Graham Day. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
President Officer, I want to use the limited time allotted to me in closing to focus on some of the specific things we're doing with the colleges to help address their current financial challenges and establish a more direct, effective and constructive way of working, because that's an essential part of the way forward here. I know a number of colleagues will be familiar with the Collaborative Tripartite Alignment Group, which we set up to find ways of easing the financial pressures facing the sector. That's brought forward often complex and difficult matters which take time to fully consider, longer than I perhaps had anticipated or would want. But what we've done is establish confidence in the process, and it's starting to pay dividends. Let me offer an example of that. Following advice from the sector on the assets that are likely to become available for disposal, the Cabinet Secretary announced at the recent College of Scotland annual conference that will embed changes so that the colleges can retain a significant proportion of value of any sale to invest locally. And that's, an example of the merits of this approach, and I think there's lots more we can do around developing that approach and looking at greater flexibility, I think, as Liam Kerr touched upon. It's in all our interest to ensure that our colleges thrive, despite the immensely difficult financial climate, and there's little doubt that these challenges sharpen the focus on what lies ahead, making the reform of the lifelong education and skills system even more critical. Now, we know that demand for a principal... forgive me, I've got very little time to do this. Please, my apologies. We know that demand, for example, for apprenticeships is greater than the number of new starts that we're able to fund. Now, this year, 24-25, we've managed to retain funding for MAs at the same level as last year, 25,500, and up to 2,500 foundation apprenticeships, despite a very challenging budget. And as Mr Kerr knows, we're looking to very much develop the foundation apprenticeship model. This level of investment has been confirmed in light of a worst-case scenario for Scotland's budget handed down by the UK government, I think, is evidence of this government's commitment to apprenticeships. But there are issues with the current contracting system, and I make no apologies for looking to tackle these. I don't, for example, believe it right that managing agents receive up to £8,700 per apprentice, and in some instances pass on only a fraction of that sum to the colleges providing training. There's an argument, a strong argument, in certain circumstances for colleges coming together to create their own managing agent structure and accessing more of that public funding, and that's been actively explored. The Scottish Government set out its intention to strengthen regional skills planning with local partners. And that will involve colleges having a critical role in this process as they better align their offering with the needs of those local economies. To assist that process, the college sector has created two short-life working groups that are contributing to our thinking. One is looking for current good practice and skills planning across Scotland's eight regional economies. The second is looking at models across the other UK nations and internationally. The objective of both groups is to arrive at a set of principles that the government can look at taking forward, and they will report next month. President Officer, briefly, I'll take an intervention from Graeme Simpson.
Graeme Simpson.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention. He'll be aware that the Public Audit Committee was told in January that four Scottish colleges are in dire straits. Is that still the position? If it is, what's he doing about it?
Minister.
Briefly, to answer, the Scottish Funding Council works closely with all colleges where they have challenging financial circumstances, and that is ongoing. I've been clear previously, President Officer, that we plan to simplify the post-school funding body landscape, including looking at the options for a single funding body, which again I think Liam Kerr touched on. And as a first step, the intention is to bring together funding for student support into one place and funding for apprenticeship provision into another. There is no question in my mind that simplification of the funding body landscape is one of the key enablers for reform and improvement across a range of priority areas. And that simplification in the apprenticeship space, I believe, will be of benefit to the colleges. So too will be reducing the number of funding pots, which we will be doing. And perhaps, of course, the real opportunity here is that provided by the upskilling and reskilling agenda, where on a commercial basis, employers can commission short, sharp courses for the workforce to be provided by our colleges. President Officer, I genuinely thank Liam Kerr for bringing forward this debate. And as the reform agenda progresses, the government looks forward to further opportunities to get into the detail, because I understand, as we've heard today, we're not necessarily articulating publicly the enormous amount of work that's been done to progress this agenda. I also think there's a genuine desire amongst members to see our colleges flourish, and amongst many of them, at least, a realism and a willingness to contribute constructively to making that happen. I actually agree with many of the points that Stephen Kerr raised earlier on. I find that quite troubling on one level, but he was right in much of what he said. And I offer to engage with those members who want to contribute constructively beyond this debate, and to meet Willie Rennie on the issue of the SRUC. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on Ros McCall to wind up the debate. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to close the debate this afternoon on supporting Scotland's colleges. Every child should have the same chance to succeed regardless of where they're from, where they went, what school they went to, or what their parents did. Education can be the single greatest leveller in our society, and it's a leveller which can spread aspiration across the whole of our country. And it's a tried and tested, and some would say most effective, route out of poverty. This is a key principle that I think we can all agree on in this chamber, and we've heard from all parties about that here this afternoon. Education, and in particular the college sector, has also got the potential to transform the economy, create flexible routes into employment, developing a skilled workforce, and delivering sustainable economic growth and reducing poverty here in Scotland. For instance, in my region of Mid-Scotland and Fife, we are blessed with several fantastic colleges, Forth Valley College, Fife College, UHI Perth, and of course SRUC that Willie Rennie has already mentioned, and I agree with him and have concerns regarding the Elmwood campus. Working in partnership with employers across the region, the college sector is critically important in addressing some of the most daunting challenges that we face as a country. Stubborn productive gap, an ageing population, low economic growth are just some of these challenges. And there are also the challenges of enabling new generations of Scottish entrepreneurs to create the businesses and jobs of tomorrow. Our primary duty is to create an education and skills landscape that's not only fit for the present, but the needs of the future. And I'm sorry to say that successive SNP education secretaries, including their new leader John Swinney, have consistently passed down cuts to the sector and not progressed with moving forward on suggested reforms. And the Withers reforms, so eloquently mentioned by Messrs. Stephen Kerr and Liam Kerr, highlight that point. These decisions are now coming. A very short one, because I don't have a lot of time.
Minister.
Water as well.
Thank you.
Can I offer her the absolute reassurance that we absolutely are committed to taking forward the overwhelming majority of the Withers recommendations.
Ros McCall.
I guess the answer to that would be a when, but I accept that intervention and appreciate it and thank it. These decisions, unfortunately, though, are coming home to roost for the SNP government, and I do want to take my time to cite one example from my region, which is the plight of UHI in Perth. UHI Perth documents sent out to staff lay out the college's financial position, saying that it must increase income or reduce costs by £4 million by July 31, 2025. Proposals include £3 million worth of staff cost savings, not including an estimated £1 million for voluntary severance pay and £1 million savings of non-staff costs. Savings will include the removal of unviable courses, cutting the higher education personal academic tutor role and removing of programmes in which school students can attend part-time learning. In addition, the current library will be turned into a more versatile study space, which will contain only a limited book collection and will be only open for one evening a week. The library assistant's role will be axed, and it also means that the on-site nursery will close. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, we heard compelling evidence on increasing parental employment as an integral part of reducing child poverty in Scotland. But there's a triple whammy of obstacles that have to be overcome to realise this goal. They are transport, upskilling and childcare. When cuts to college funding directly hit two of these avenues, reducing the courses and closing the childcare facilities, it asks the question, does the Scottish Government truly want to eradicate child poverty? Because if they did, then the forthcoming changes at Perth UHI would be ringing serious alarm bells. As I mentioned, we have heard all the platitudes from the SNP about the importance of education and the role that our colleges play. However, ministers simply cannot pretend that they agree with the need to change outcomes and then consistently undercut the delivery of those outcomes. The financial strain that colleges such as UHI Perth are under is bad enough, but the SNP government is failing them on many fronts, and I think that point was made very eloquently earlier on by my colleague Liam Kerr. The Scottish Government is actively shunning much-needed reform in the sector and have seemingly completely ignored the recommendations of the Education and Young People Committee report on college regionalisation, which has also been mentioned by Sue Webber and Liam Kerr. Their report stated, "The committee is concerned that colleges are currently making decisions to respond to the challenging financial climate without clear, overarching strategic direction from the Scottish Government as to their purpose and what they must prioritise. As such, colleges are being asked to take decisions for the future, uncertain as to whether those decisions will be compatible with the Scottish Government's vision." It's shunning much-needed reforms, and they have not created the environment in which colleges can be flexible or show more innovation. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, and I've got there, the potential and indeed existing outputs of Scotland's colleges are incredible, led by brilliant staff and talented and committed students, but they're being let down by the SNP government. Colleges need help boost our economy and deliver a workforce for the future. The Scottish Government must now listen today to these calls from these benches and the sector. Otherwise, colleges will only continue to suffer. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on supporting Scotland's colleges. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 13139 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to business. Any member who wishes to speak on the motion should press their request to speak button now, and I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. I note that Ms McNeill, Pauline McNeill, has asked to speak on the motion. Okay. Thank you. Ms McNeill does not wish to speak on the motion. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13139 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13122 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak on the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Douglas Ross to speak to and move Amendment 13122.1. Up to 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This is now the third time I have sought to make a change to the business put forward by the Scottish Government. I put forward the option for Parliament to hear from the Lord Advocate by staying back for just 30 minutes. The SNP and the Greens refused that proposal last week. The SNP and the Greens refused that proposal yesterday. I hope now that Parliament can unite and agree to stay behind for just 30 more minutes tomorrow to hear from the Lord Advocate. The Minister will rightly say that at the heart of this, those we have to be concerned about are the sub-postmasters wrongly convicted because of the Horizon scandal. And I agree wholeheartedly with what George Adam says on that basis. But they are not being served at all if we are still unclear what the position is of the Lord Advocate in Scotland. Now, we know nothing has changed with the reshuffle today. Not a single portfolio on the front bench has changed. The people are still there and they are doing the exact same job. So we know Angela Constance will take through the Horizon Bill in the coming weeks. What we don't know is what the head of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in Scotland thinks about that. And we don't know what she thinks as a member of the Scottish Government Cabinet. Now, the Minister has said repeatedly there is no need for any further clarity. But there is. So we now have a lot of SNP and Green members in this chamber. So I am happy to give way and give any time up to SNP and Green members if they can tell me, does the Lord Advocate still believe it would be wrong to have a process of mass exoneration for sub-postmasters or not? Can any SNP or Green member who may be about to vote against getting the Lord Advocate into this chamber to tell us, outline the position of the Lord Advocate? And they can't. I'll come to Pauline McNeill in a minute. They can't. So, Presiding Officer, I just can't fathom how democratically elected members sent to this chamber to represent their constituents can vote down a proposal to sit just for 30 extra minutes to get that vital answer from the Lord Advocate. No, they're all looking at their desks and their phones. The answer is not there either. So if we don't know, please, I would genuinely urge SNP and Green members to vote for this slight change to the business tomorrow to get the Lord Advocate here. And if SNP and Green members aren't willing to contribute, I will happily give way to Pauline McNeill.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Yet again, Scottish Labour will support the amendment to the business motion tonight because we do believe there should be a statement from the Lord Advocate. I want to say why. There is emerging evidence that the Crown Office either knew that the Horizon system was questionable or ought to have known that it was questionable, and we still do not have answers for this. We will be supporting any attempts to overturn convictions and obviously need to see the detail of the bill. The Presiding Officer, it's not going to be enough for victims simply to have their convictions overturned. In fact, there were six cases in the appeal court this week in which it was deemed that the Horizon evidence was not corroboration, and so those cases were overturned. But victims will want to see accountability for the full timeline of who took decisions and why they didn't take better decisions and resulted in these prosecutions in the first place. I think a statement and detailed question and answer is what victims would want here.
Douglas Ross.
I agree wholeheartedly with the comments from Pauline McNeill. And as I said yesterday, she has a question to the First Minister tomorrow on this subject. Really, that question would be probably more suitable going to the Lord Advocate herself to hear her position on that point and many others. As I sum up, Presiding Officer, I am left wondering why the SNP and Green MSPs wouldn't support this change today. Is the Lord Advocate comfortable with that? Is she sat in her chamber saying, don't allow time for me to come to the Scottish Parliament to explain my position like I did in January of this year? Or are the Scottish Government now blocking that opportunity for the Lord Advocate to come to the chamber, which is her right and our right as MSPs to ask her here? So as I move the amendment in my name, I would simply ask the Minister, if none of his SNP and Green colleagues could intervene and tell me, can he? Does Scotland's Lord Advocate, who sits round the Scottish Government cabinet table, still believe it would be wrong to have a mass exoneration of sub-postmasters in Scotland?
Thank you, and I call on George Adam to respond. Up to 5 minutes, Minister.
Presiding Officer, thank you. And at least let's talk about the positives. We now all agree that those involved in the post office scandal, those that suffered it, are actually the ones that we should be thinking of. Mr Ross said that today as well, and they are. They are the most important one. These are families. These are individuals, which I've said yesterday, I said last week as well, who have had to deal with this ongoing problem for decades as this has gone on. But just to make everyone's mind, put everyone's mind at ease, lead responsibility for developing and delivering the Post Office Horizon legislation lies with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, and it would be inappropriate for the Lord Advocate to provide a statement on this bill. And that's the important thing that we're talking about here, is all of these individuals who have agreed, all of these people who we want to help, are the important ones here at this stage. And as I explained yesterday, all members during that process, when we go through the parliamentary process, all members will get the opportunity to scrutinise the Scottish Government bill as it progresses through Parliament in the usual manner. And there's nothing else I have to add at this point, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 13122.1 in the name of Douglas Ross, which seeks to amend Motion 13122 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.